the experimental class, we have seen how we can actually determine and quantify the protein ligand interaction. So the protein we have taken there was HSA, and two ligands we have taken, one is curcumin and the other is gallic acid. So now we will study the actual structural background, or rather how the docking or how the interaction takes place. Now talking about docking, I won't go into detail, so rather I will touch the peripheral part and will show you how we can actually see or how we can actually structurally analyze the protein ligand interaction. Now I will show you just the structure of the ligands, the structure of the protein and protein ligand complex. Okay. So now we have taken two ligands. The first ligand is curcumin and the second ligand is gallic acid. So the structure of these two compounds most of you might have been familiar with. Now this curcumin have these two aromatic rings out here. This one is number 1 and this one is number 2. Okay. And this gallic acid has only one aromatic ring. Okay. And now we will see how the structure looks when you take it on a computational level. Okay. So talking about this one, the first thing we can actually see is about curcumin. So this is the structure of curcumin, and when we take curcumin, when we analyze this in any software in a computer using any sort of software, okay, let it be Gaussian or any sort of software, this is the ball and stick model of curcumin. Okay. So here we can see, so this one is actually one of the rings of curcumin. This has been marked in purple, okay, as you can see. Now this ring actually corresponds to this structure. Okay. So this structure we can actually correlate with this one. Why? Because if we take into account of this moiety, okay, this moiety and this moiety, this is the OCH3 part, and this one is also the OCH3 part. Okay. Now let's move to the next molecule. The next molecule is actually gallic acid. Out here we can see that this gallic acid has three OH groups and one COOH group. Generally this type of molecules are known as your polyphenolic compounds. Okay. So first we have seen the structure of curcumin, and next we have seen the structure of gallic acid. Now this is the human serum albumin. Well, this looks pretty good in terms of color combination, but however the structure is a bit complex. Here we can see several helices are there. Okay. This one is one of the alpha helix, this one is one of the alpha helix. So this HSA compound have these different types of alpha helices, okay, as we can see. Now generally this human serum albumin protein have this heart shaped structure, okay, and this structure has several domains, and out here there is one tryptophan residue. So important thing about this protein is that it has only one tryptophan residue. Okay. Now what we have done, we have taken this HSA protein and we have used two different ligands. So this part, what we have done this actually using experimental techniques. Okay. However, on the contrary, on this stage what we will do, we will take some computational tools generally known as docking studies. So docking studies many of you might have heard or many of you might not be familiar with. Okay. So docking studies basically takes into account of this protein structure, and it basically places either one of the ligands out here, that is either curcumin or gallic acid, it places here and it gives the structure of the protein ligand complex. Now we will see how this protein ligand complex looks like. So this is a structure of human serum albumin protein. Okay. So now what we can do, we can actually play this small movie here in which we can actually see the structure of this protein. But there are two different types of molecule out here, and one of this molecule, as we can see, is very familiar molecule, which is our gallic acid. So this is the gallic acid molecule, okay. So gallic acid basically attaches to this region, fine. Now if you play the structure, and here we can see that gallic acid attaches to the protein around this helices, okay. So if we just pause this one for a while, and if we see this, we can see that this is a protein, and there are several alpha helices as we have discussed previously, and this one is a tryptophan residue out here. The tryptophan residue is something out here, okay, and this one is the gallic acid moiety. Now gallic acid attaches to this part of the protein, okay. There are several parts, but gallic acid specifically attaches to this part of the protein. Now let's play the structure once again. So if we are interested in knowing the distance between the tryptophan residue and the gallic acid, we can actually easily do it by measuring the bond length, or basically this is not the actual bond length since there are no such bonds, but this is the distance between the two atoms, okay. So here we have selected one of the atoms out here, that is one of the atoms we have selected is our nitrogen atom of tryptophan, and the second atom we have selected is the oxygen, the OH group oxygen of gallic acid, and we are measuring the distance. So let's see the distance. The distance is around 10.4 angstrom. So this is the average distance, okay. So this is the average distance of gallic acid from our tryptophan residue of HSA. Now an interesting thing is that gallic acid attaches to this part of the protein, okay. However, so there might be some sort of attractive interaction which stabilizes this gallic acid to this region of the protein. Since we cannot see any sort of covalent bondage, so there might be some sort of non-covalent bondages which actually stabilizes this moiety in this part of the protein. So for that, we have actually selected a few local regions around this gallic acid moiety, and these are the protein residues. We have labeled it. And in order to visualize it properly, we have to first neglect the ribbon structure. In order to see the residues, amino acid residues, we have to remove the ribbon structure. We have removed it, and now we can see the nearby residues around this gallic acid. So if we pause this for a while, and if we analyze this, what we can see is actually this type of structure. There are tyrosine residues, okay. Now there are alanine residues, there is arginine residues, okay, and this UNK part is basically our gallic acid moiety, okay, and here is also arginine residues, fine, and here is leucine residues, and here is also leucine, okay. So one important thing we can see out here, that there are polar residues, okay, and one aromatic residues. This one is your tyrosine, and the number is written, the residue number is written just next to it, okay. So out here we can see there are polar as well as non-polar and aromatic residues around this gallic acid moiety. Now if we visualize this structure from different angles, we can actually see that these residues actually have shielded this gallic acid moiety, which basically signifies that there are some sort of weak interactions might be prevailing out here. So what are the interactions might be prevalent out there? So since this gallic acid has this red part, is actually the oxygen, this one is the oxygen, and this green parts are actually nitrogen, okay. So and this is the white part is actually hydrogen. So what happens in this case, if here is oxygen atom is attached here, and this is OH, this is for gallic acid, okay, and out here there is any amino acid residues whose NH2 is out here, or NH2 or any sort of residue. So there might be some sort of hydrogen bonding interaction might take place out here, okay. Again, this might interact with nitrogen also for hydrogen bonding. So what I am trying to portray out here. So the interaction which actually take place during protein ligand interaction might be hydrogen bonding. But again, apart from hydrogen bonding, there is this tyrosine residue, okay. So tyrosine residue has an aromatic part. So tyrosine residue is basically like this, okay. And this one, this aromatic part, and apart from this, there is alanine residue, alanine, and also leucine. So these all are aromatic. So what happens actually in case of gallic acid? In gallic acid, we can see there is one aromatic moiety, aromatic part in gallic acid. So there might be some sort of, what we can say, hydrophobic or aromatic interactions out there, and also hydrophobic interaction might exist between alanine and also leucine. So out there, what we can actually suggest, that apart from, actually you can see this structure, apart from hydrogen bonding, there might be some sort of hydrophobic interaction which basically stabilizes this gallic acid structure within this residues, okay. So we can also see the tryptophan residues moving around here. So these are all the three dimensional structures, there are various structures. So this part, we can see that several residues are surrounding this gallic acid, and these residues are kept at a distance of around 3 angstrom from gallic acid. So you can actually measure, we can actually estimate the number of residues around it, okay. So these are the images, or these are the video taken from various angles in the software, okay. So now what we can do, we can actually see the structure of gallic acid within the protein moiety. Again, we are back with the primary structure. And one important thing out here is we can see that the gallic acid present here is shielded, okay. So the gallic acid is shielded out here, so we can't actually see the gallic acid. So as we have discussed in the experimental part, that during the UV absorbance, since our molecule, that is the our point of interest, the ligand is actually getting shielded, so its absorbance might decrease. So the absorbance of gallic acid decreases, as we have already seen. Now this is another molecule, and as we have seen previously, this molecule is actually curcumin, okay. However, the point of attachment of curcumin is somewhat different than that of gallic acid, okay. So curcumin attaches in this cleft, okay. In this cleft, the curcumin attaches out here. Curcumin attaches in the cleft, again nearby to the alpha helices. So different ligands have different regions of attachment in the protein, okay. And we have selected the tryptophan residue, okay. This tryptophan of HS is actually tryptophan 214, fine. So this tryptophan residue, we are measuring the distance between this curcumin and tryptophan. For that, we first select a residue, a particular atom of curcumin, and the tryptophan residue. And now we are interested in measuring a distance. The distance now is actually 12.63 angstrom, as we can see. Now this distance is quite higher than that of the gallic acid, which shows that gallic acid binds to a region near the tryptophan residue. This information might be important if we measure the fluorescence emission spectra, okay. However, here also we have seen that curcumin is shielded. Now we are interested in finding the stabilizing force of curcumin within this cleft of the protein, okay. For that, what we need to do, we need to select this curcumin. For selection, we need to first allow curcumin to bind to the region of this protein and select the nearby region, that is the region around 3 angstrom from this curcumin, and these are the residues, and we can label this one, and it seems a bit cumbersome, and for that we actually neglect and we actually hide the ribbon structure of this protein. And then if we see this one, okay, we can basically see that in similarly here also, this one is actually curcumin. So, this one is actually our curcumin ring, okay, and nearby we can see alanine, and here is valine, and here is aspartate, here is histidine, okay, and there is also another ring where we can see lysine, here is another lysine, okay, and here is another lysine, okay. So, what we can say from here that there are polar residues as well as non-polar residues surrounding this curcumin. And now let us just go through this structure, and if we see the residues around it, we can actually say that there are in a similar way hydrophilic as well as hydrophobic interaction, which basically stabilizes this curcumin at this point. Okay. Similarly, what we can see, there is another tyrosine residue out here. So, this tyrosine residue actually suggests that aromatic part of curcumin, that curcumin has also an aromatic ring, okay, two aromatic rings basically. There might be some sort of hydrophobic interaction between this aromatic ring and this tyrosine residues, since this tyrosine residue is located quite close to one of the aromatic rings of curcumin. So, as we have seen, these are the stabilizing interactions which basically stabilizes this curcumin in HSA. However, one important thing out here is that for both HSA and gallic acid, what we can see is that for gallic acid HSA, it attaches to a region around this tryptophan. So, it attaches out here. This is the region where gallic acid attaches. However, this is the region where curcumin attaches. So, the region of attachment in a protein varies for different ligands. From this way, what we can actually estimate, the extent of interaction actually varies. So, what we can say, the extent of interaction given by Ka or association constant depend on the region where ligand binds. Okay. Why? Because as we know, depending upon the various regions, amino acid residues may vary. So, in different region there might be different sorts of amino acid residues, and depending upon the different types of amino acid residues, this Ka value varies. So, in this study what we have seen, we have actually seen how the interaction between gallic acid and curcumin can be visualized using computational tools. These are quite at an advanced level, and these are not actually in your syllabus which you are studying out here. However, for a better, for a advanced study, I am showing you this one, and this might be helpful in analyzing the experimental techniques.